Buongiorno e facciamo il solito test di audio e video in attesa di iniziare. Buongiorno e... Of course, English oral exam on June 19 will be online. The exams on June 19 will be done with the usual procedure from remote. So, the usual procedure. And I cannot tell you whether it will be done in all in one day or not, because it depends on how many students will sign in. For example, on June 3rd, we are pretty sure that it will be one day and a half, so we will go on also for another day, half a day, let us say June 3rd and in the morning of June 4th. I have to stop streaming for a moment and restart streaming. Okay, I had to restart because I was on the wireless network by mistake and let me try this. And see what happens. So still quality very poor. Can you confirm that the quality of the video is very poor? I don't understand why, because so they are both good for you, because my what I have here on my screen, I see the image completely blurred. I don't understand why. Okay, if you say it's good. I will try to do another thing. Log out from my channel and log in again. Ok, now much better. Now I see everything as it should. Okay, anyway, let us wait another couple of minutes. Now everything should be okay. So if you have questions, related to what we saw last time, I added also some, rather than, it's the same thing that is here in the handwritten notes that I added, but I put them also into a more readable form, if you wish. So I added some slides, and this material is now on the website. If the video quality is poor, what I did, I exited YouTube and re-entered it, re-entered my channel. And it worked. Okay, we can start, and perhaps today, if we are efficient, we will be able to close the issue of radiometric measurements. And I would like to start, however, by summarizing what we did with range measurements, because perhaps range measurements are the more difficult to understand, not for the concept itself, but for the way in which the ambiguity is resolved. And what I showed you is a method using tones of multiple frequencies that allows to attain a fairly good accuracy and at the same time solve the inherent ambiguity of every tone measurement. So we started by considering the signal. Let me pick up the pen, the signal, which is phase modulated with a ranging signal. The ranging signal that we have chosen is a sine waves. It makes computation easier because we can use the Jacobi-Anger identities. And with some mathematical steps, not particularly complex, we arrived at the formulas that are written here. These formula are an approximation that one obtains when the Jacobi-Anger identities are truncated to the first order to J1, because otherwise we would have, as I said, additional harmonics on the side. This term is the ranging modulation. This term is the carrier. One thing that perhaps I did not tell you explicitly last time is that you can see that the carrier power is decreased by an amount which depends on the depth of the modulation, or the modulation index, M ranging. A different way to write the same equation in terms of power is the following. If you remember, we used the signal, the amplitude of the signal indicated it with A, but A can be written also with as a square root of the total power. Why? Because if we have a sinusoidal wave, the average of a sinusoid squared over a period, so integral from 0 to 2 pi of sine square x in dx, is equal to 1/2. So we know that. And we know that the power is also the square of the amplitude divided in this case by 2, because the signal is a sinusoid. So when we take the sinusoid square and divide it by the unit time or the period, we get this factor 1/2. So the total power expressed as a function of the amplitude of the signal is a square divided by 2. So if we want to have an explicit expression including the power, we have to replace A with square root of twice total power. So the total power, what is the total power? The total power is the total power provided by the amplifier. Then we do this phase modulation and the total available power gets split among the different components. The residual carrier, which is this first term, you see, at the frequency omega c is the carrier, so is this frequency, fc, is reduced by a factor j square, j0 square, as a function of the modulation index m ranging. This function starts from zero. J0 of 0 is equal to 1 and decreases as an asymptotic law that we have seen last time, not very fast, but decreases as the modulation index increases. So if we want to leave a strong or sufficiently strong signal power, we have to use a modulation index which is not which does not differ from unity too much. Let us say 0.1, 0.2. But we can compute how much power will be left in the carrier using the order 0 Bessel function. For the ranging signal is the opposite, because if m is small, the ranging signal in one sideband, so for example on this side, okay, on one sideband is p tot j1 square of m. So we know already, if you remember here, we have this approximation, which derives from this approximation here. We know that J1 square is approximately equal to M square divided by 4. So we have P tot. M1 square, M ranging square, sorry, divided by 4. So this is the power that we get into one sideband. But since we produce sidebands and there are ways at the ground antenna to combine the received power and the two sidebands, which are coherent, the total power in the two sidebands will be the following, this one. So in the end, it will be M ranging divided by 4 square. Okay, divided by, sorry, by 2, because there is this additional 2. Okay, so we use the ranging modulation to resolve the range, to compute the range. And we have seen how this is done. So we have taken into account first a situation in which the ground antenna and the spacecraft don't move relative to each other. A very idealized situation that we will abandon soon. And we have seen how by correlating the incoming signal, or better, take the scalar product over an integral t of the incoming signal and the outgoing signal, it's possible to estimate, so from this integral eta, it's possible to estimate the round trip lifetime or the range, rho uplink plus rho downlink, with some ambiguity. And the ambiguity is an integer number of the wavelength of the tone. So, for example, if we are using a tone of 1 MHz, 300 meters wavelength, this means that the ambiguity is 300 meters. And we cannot do much with that. But if we use a tone frequency of 1 kHz, then the ambiguity becomes 300 km. And we can hope that the navigation team is able to provide an a priori estimate of the range with an uncertainty less than 300 km. And this is always for the case, as we have said. So in this plot, in these two plots, I've tried to explain, because there were some questions from you last time, on how this is done. And let us consider this plot. This plot refers to the NASA ranging system, which uses square waves rather than sine waves. Okay? Square waves of different wavelength, and all the wavelength are in a ratio of 2, so the frequency increases from a fundamental frequency as with powers of 2. And you can see here, for example, in one wavelength of this tone, from here to here, there are two wavelength of the higher frequency tone, okay? And everything is done coherent. Let me erase everything. And move on. So the station, what the station does, produces this quantity eta. Okay? And we have seen that from the quantity eta, we can get the round trip lifetime according to this formula with some ambiguity plus n, a fundamental, let us call this is time delta tau. Okay? Which is the period of the wave. Rather than tau, let me call it T omega, the period corresponding to omega, the frequency omega that is used. So from this tau, we have this ambiguity, and if the measured tau is, for example, this one, okay, the spacecraft is here, so the spacecraft can be at any of this location, here or here. I thought, to be honest, to have put some additional notes here or here. Okay, all these arrows, red arrows, and correspond, you see, to this place, etc. So we know that the spacecraft can be in any of these locations. When we use, let us say, the higher frequency tone. When we go at a lower frequency tone, the spacecraft can be, of course, here at this location, or can be at this location here, displaced by one wavelength. Okay? And multiple of it. So we see that we have less choices now. If we go at even lower frequency, the measure at eta, and remember that eta is a function of the wavelength. So for different wavelength, one would find different etas. That must be clear. So when the wavelength is 4 lambda, the only affordable position, you see, is this one. Why? Because we have a range uncertainty a priori, which is of this order. Okay, so the only measurement that is compatible with the a priori uncertainty is this one. One could have said, okay, but even with 2 lambda, I was almost already sure that there was only one arrow that is compatible. True, this is true, but due to possible jitters, thermal noise, etc., what one does is generally to stop at a frequency which gives an additional safety margin. So we don't stop at the first frequency, which is in principle able to resolve the ambiguity. We try to go to an even lower frequency. We do another measurement to see whether the two are in agreement. Okay, and this is what is depicted here. Again, this is the same thing explained in a different layout, with some explanation, and you can see that I've in the first line I put the possible position of the spacecraft at these points where the black arrows are. All right. The true spacecraft range is indicated with this dashed line, this one. And let us say that the ground antenna is indicated in this plot by this other dashed line. So how do we solve the ambiguity? We have an a priori uncertainty, which is the blue segment with the two arrows at the tip. This is the estimated position based on a priori navigation solution. And the two tips are the possible locations, extreme, the interval of confidence for the spacecraft location. Of course, you have to take some margin in identifying this interval. You don't choose simply the formal uncertainty. You take some margin, and the margin may be a factor of 5 or 6 over the formal sigma, just to be sure that you are not making mistakes. And again, if we go from a wavelength lambda to a wavelength 2 lambda, you see, possible location of the spacecraft, since eta changes, is this, this, and this one. Still, it's not enough, you see, in this case, to resolve the ambiguity, because there are two black arrows that fall within the blue segment. But if we go to four lambda, there is only one arrow, this one, that falls within the possible a priori interval. So you see, the spacecraft range is this, and we have to apply a correction with respect to the a priori value, which is equal to what I indicated now. Okay? So this is another way of seeing how the ambiguity is resolved. And I hope now that everything is clearer than last time. Okay, I added these slides, which are in the additional material. Okay, in the new version of part two of the slides. So if there are any questions, let me know. We move on, and one may wonder, but what is the uncertainty in a range measurement? And what is the uncertainty also in Doppler measurement? The two things are related by the effect of thermal noise. We have seen that there are many noise sources, propagation media, for example. We have seen the mechanical noise of the antenna, etc., etc. But there is also the thermal noise of the receiver, and we have not taken it into account, not at all. If we go back, let us go back here and delete everything. Okay, if we go back to this slide, you have to imagine that the received signal is made up by B cosine omega T and the argument plus noise. And this noise is the noise introduced by the media, introduced by many things, but we will consider for the time being only thermal noise, only thermal noise. So you see that if you add the noise in this equation, you would get another noise term plus, let us call it delta eta. Okay, and this appears as noise. Delta eta then will reflect into the accuracy of the measurement. So rho uplink plus rho downlink here is made up by this term plus a delta rho, an error, which is due to the presence of the noise that so far we have neglected. The computation can be done, but we will not do it. We will just provide the formula and make some explanation on the formula. It's showing that, after all, it's not so unreasonable. So what you have here is sigma r is the error in the range measurement, which is, we can write as the speed of light divided, multiplied by sigma tau, an error in time divided by two. Time is the one-way light time. But forget it. Sigma r has this expression. First of all, and this is an expression valid for square waves. If one uses sine waves, this coefficient 16 changes and becomes 4 pi, but the order of magnitude is the same. So let us see what happens. First of all, is inversely, the error is inversely proportional to the square root, so 1, so square root over ranging power over n0, the thermal noise, power density, and this is to the minus 1/2. So the larger the signal to noise ratio, not surprisingly, the more accurate the ranging measurement is. Okay? The more accurate the ranging measurement is. We will see an example, I will make you an example related to Doppler, which may explain why we have this dependence. But no surprise. The cleaner the signal, the better the noise. The other important term is T, the integration time. We have learned already when we saw the coherent demodulation demodulator that the integration time is a tool, is an excellent tool to beat low signal to noise ratio and decrease the bit error rate. You remember we computed the ratio between the signal output of the matched filter to the output of the noise from the matched filter. The signal output increased the square root, like time, was proportional to time. The signal output, the noise output, on the contrary, increased only as the square root of the time. So when one takes the ratio between signal and noise and the matched filter output, one has a net gain proportional to the square root of the integration time. And we have seen also with the MATLAB program how this works. Here is the same. The accuracy is inversely proportional to the square root of time. 1 over square root of integration time. Remember, t is the integration time. In the integral, when we produced the quantity eta, we had to integrate the product of the incoming signal with the outgoing signal and integrate over a time t. Okay, this is again to beat thermal noise. And this is the way. The other important and perhaps less obvious dependence, which is fairly strong, is from the frequency of the tone. And here we see that the ranging error is inversely proportional to the frequency of the largest of the frequency tone that we have. So, if we have 1 kHz, Ft is equal 1 kHz, for the same SNR, same integration time, etc., we get a range error which is 1,000 times larger than if we use a 1 MHz tone. So, the dependence is very strong. And these points to the need to use higher frequency tones. For example, and I will give during the break, I will show you some, I will load some slides, some results that we have obtained from with the Spacecam Bepicolombo with a different system. It's not really a tone system, it's a more advanced. Is a pseudo noise modulation that we are doing on the carrier. I will show you some examples of accuracy that can be attained in that case by using a higher frequency, 24 megachip per second signal. Why do we have this dependence on the frequency? Well, I made you an example, a sort of example that I always make. If you want to determine what is the maximum point on the tip of a mountain or of a hill, and you are in a rather rough terrain with some undulation, etc. If you are on the top of a mountain which is very peaked, identifying the tip, the position of the tip is relatively easy. Because a tiny displacement would give a big drop in amplitude. If you are on a shallow hill, identifying the maximum, which in this case is here, is a much more tricky task, especially if you think that here you may have a rough terrain, okay, which corresponds to noise in our case. So the more peaked are the sine waves, the easier is the identification of the maxima and therefore of the true range. Okay, so this is the fundamental reason why we have this dependence on FT. Current systems, one can do a computation, simple computation, to get what the accuracy is in current system. Do we want to let us make an example. Let us make it. So, let us put some numbers and suppose that P ranging over N0 is equal to, let us say, is 10 dB. Hertz, I should say, is in a bandwidth of 1 Hz. So PR of an N0 is equal 10. So we have 3 in 10 to the 8, we do everything in meter, divided by 16 multiplied by 10 to the 6 meters, and then we have a factor of 10, and suppose that we integrate for 60 seconds. Okay, so this is a square root of 600. What is the result? The result, square root of 600 square root of 6 is about, so we have 3 divided by 16 times, let us say, 2, between something between 2 and 3, 32, let us say 40 in 10 to the 6. 10 to the 7. This turns out to be roughly 0.75 meters. Okay, we have used a fairly large signal-to-noise ratio, but this is the accuracy that one can get for thermal noise under these circumstances, this situation. And this is 3 in 10 to the 8, of course. Yes, I did it right. And the number returns. But if you use a frequency, for example, that is 10 times larger, you immediately get down to 7 centimeters. So a much better accuracy. Tone system existing today, they are limited to accuracies of the order of 1 meter or so, not only because of thermal noise, but also because there are no other noise sources that we have described, propagation media, for example. There are also other effects which are systematics and therefore very dangerous related to the station bias. There are standing waves in the waveguides that sometimes give rise to a bias in the range measurements. These are very dangerous. The station does always a calibration cycle before and after the pass to have an estimate of how much these biases can be, provided that they are stable during a tracking pass. Let us, however, let me see what time is it. We have 8 minutes, which is enough to put ourselves in a more realistic situation. We have done all the analysis by assuming that the ground antenna and the spacecraft didn't change their distance during the integration time. Okay? But we know that if the integration time lasts, for example, 1 minute, the spacecraft and the antenna move with respect to each other and move by a lot. So the round trip light time, which is rho uplink plus rho downlink divided by the group velocity, is changing with time. And is changing during the integration. Okay? So the received signal, which I write it here, is not must be modified in order to include a changing round trip light time. So we write B cosine omega t minus, instead of a constant round trip light time, now we take into account that the round trip light time is a function of time. But luckily, this change in round trip light time is available to the ground antenna because we do at the same time Doppler range rate measurements. And therefore, we can write that tau as a function of time is equal to tau zero, which is the round trip playtime at the start of the integration interval, plus a term which is the following integral from 0 to t. 0 is the time at which we start the integration. We integrate the measured round trip playtime, the t prime. Here there should be a t prime. Okay. And this quantity, however, let me put a dot. So we integrate the range rate, which is tau dot, to get the correction. Okay? Now we know that tau dot is available at the ground antenna because Doppler measurements do exactly this. You remember, look here, that the delta range between t0 and t is equal to the integral of rho dot in dt. So if we integrate the Doppler is a velocity. If we integrate a velocity, we get a distance, and this is the delta range. Now we can express rho dot as C delta omega over omega, because you remember that rho dot over C is equal to delta F over F, the formula of the Doppler shift. Here I've used omega rather than F, but the ratio is the same. So C, rho dot, is equal to C delta omega divided by omega, which is a quantity measured by the ground antenna, because it's the Doppler measurement. And of course, this quantity is nothing but C times the integral of the round trip playtime. Okay? It follows exactly from this formula. Okay? So the quantity that we need, which is this one, okay, this, is provided by the range rate system. And this is why this method is called rate-aided measurement. So this is the integral, you see, we can expand the received signal in this way, with this approximation. Let us move forward. And therefore, the trick to avoid the motion of the station with respect to the spacecraft is to use as a bit signal not simply A cosine omega t, but a version with a different phase, so A cosine omega t, but with a phase which is decreased by the amount, exactly by the amount that corresponds to the Doppler shift. Since this is available electronically, it's fairly easy to produce a bit signal of this kind. Okay, so the bit signal is the following, this one. And when you beat, the signal generated at the station, which is this one, with the received signal. So this is the in signal. Sorry, this is the out signal. No, this is the in signal. I'm making mistakes. And this is not even the, this is not the outgoing signal, because the outgoing signal stops here. But this is a correction. This part where the integral is a correction. The, when you do the multiplication of the two cosines at the low frequency component, this cancels out with this one. When you do the multiplication of the two cosine, you see, when you do the multiplication of the two cosine, you get the cosine of the difference plus the cosine of the sum. The cosine of the difference cancels out the Doppler shift, the term due to the change in round trip light time. The cosine at twice the frequency is cancelled out by the integration. So we end up with this expression, because omega tau zero, of course, survives. And we can say, with this method, which is called Doppler rate aiding, you can see here Doppler rate aiding, we obtain the range at the start of the integration interval. Okay? As written here in red. In practice, it's as if we artificially put in motion the station using the Doppler information, put in motion the station in such a way that the relative distance between the ground antenna, the station, and the spacecraft doesn't change over the integration interval. Okay? So this is what is done electronically. And it's time to do the break. So we'll break here. And we'll reconvene at 11:17. All right? If there are questions on the chat, please do. I will try to show you some slides. After the break. Slides from tests that we made last May with about 1 year ago with the spacecraft Bepi Colombo. So please, if there are questions, don't hesitate to ask. So I will publish today also on the website. We'll do a test of the multiple choice test and also of the exam on Friday 29 at 4:30 p.m. And you are those of you who have to take the multiple choice test, are really advised to attend it. We will follow then, after we have done this, with the test of the oral exam. And this will mean that all of you should attend this test. Because I think this will be the first exam that you will be doing in remote, probably. So, to avoid complications on the 3rd, on June 3rd, it's better if you attend this test. On the 3rd, we will start with the multiple choice test at 9 a.m. All this will be published on my website and will be communicated also through by email. So we will start with the multiple choice test. After the multiple choice test, we will ask each student who took it whether he is willing, he or she is willing to take the exam later in the day. We will start first with the people, the students who don't have to take the multiple choice test. And then, after we have completed them, we will start the students who have to do the multiple choice test. And this probably, as I said, will be either late in the day on June 3rd or on the following day in the morning. So there are some questions. Would be is the Vienna City is asking if the exam will be global for all of you or no, it's only for the students who have to take are willing to take or want to take the exam on June 3rd. Okay, so we said we will do one multiple choice test per each exam session, not one per month. I said it also last time, and I think I published also on the website. So to simplify matters, which are already fairly complicated, the multiple choice test will be done prior to each exam session. Let me know if have been clear or not. Then there is another question. No, I don't. Fabrizio Scialli is saying to do the multiple choice test to everyone. No, the students who don't need to take the multiple choice test, of course, they must not do the multiple choice test, and there is no reason to attend the test of the multiple choice test. However, after the test, the multiple choice test on May 29, we will do a test of the oral exam. We will go through the procedures of the oral exam. And that is something advisable, highly advisable to attend for all students. Clear? I hope this is clear now. Please confirm on the chat. If not, I will repeat. All right. So we can start again. And what I put, I will show you now are results, as I said, as I told you, of a tracking system of Bepi Colombo. Bepi Colombo is a spacecraft of the European Space Agency, actually is a joint venture between the European Space Agency and JAXA, the Japanese Space Agency, to bring two elements to Mercury in 2025. So the radio system of Bepi Colombo is really unique and is the most advanced ever flown on a planetary spacecraft because we have a multi-link at X and Ka band for plasma noise cancellation, in addition to an onboard accelerometer for the measurement of the non-gravitational accelerations. And this material that I will show is was presented last year in September by the people of my group in collaboration with some JPL colleagues. Okay, let us go through the radio system of Bepi Colombo, which may be instructive. So, on board, what is described here is the onboard radio system, which is made up in white. You see the parts. I may have shown this to you already, the parts related to the standard TTNC people system. So for navigation, telemetry, etc., etc. And in addition, in yellow, we have an instrument, a Ka band. Let me get the pen. We have this KAT, which is a Ka band transponder, you see, from 34 GHz to 32 GHz, which includes also a solid state amplifier, very low power. It's only 1.5 watt, so very, very, not much power, but enough to make excellent measurement. And it's still amazing how one can get radiometric measurements that are so accurate using such a low power from distances which are even larger than one astronomical unit. Okay? This instrument, the KAT, is equipped with a novel ranging system. Okay. At 24 megachip per second. It's not really a tone system, it's something more sophisticated, which has essentially uses a single tone and some pseudo noise components to resolve the ambiguity. The problem is always the ambiguity resolution. And post calibration, the accuracy that we were able to get was less than 2-3 centimeters. The range rate accuracy at 1000 seconds was 3 microns per second. So during this experiment, the planetary geodesy and fundamental physics experiment, There will be five frequencies in the sky. You see? A KA coherent with a KA, and then two uplink, one at X band, and this coherently retransmitted at two frequencies, and X and K. Of course, these 2K frequencies are slightly separated in frequency. They differ by a few megahertz. Few tens of megahertz actually, in order to avoid again interferences, and they must be separated at the ground antenna. So this complex multi-link system is important to cancel out plasma noise, especially plasma noise from the solar corona. A number of passes was done. What is the received power, just to give you an idea? So these are the days of year. You see, in May last year, this is the distance from the Earth in units of 10 million kilometers. So we were not even at one astronomical unit. This is one third of an AU. Okay. And the signal received power here ranged was about minus 100 dBm at Malargue, e slightly larger at Goldstone. The spacecraft was tracked by two antennas. One antenna is located in Argentina, is a European antenna. And the other located in Goldstone in the California desert, belonging to the Deep Space Network of NASA. Okay, these are the elevation plot, something very important, and you can see that at Malargue the visibility of the spacecraft for purely geometrical reason was much better than in Goldstone. The elevation you see in Goldstone reached was just above 30 degrees, pretty much is a seasonal effect, of course. And what I want to show you are some examples of Doppler and the range residuals that we obtained. Okay, so here you have Doppler range rate, and here you have range residuals. You can read here the standard deviation of the range residuals, which with just 4.2 second integration time, so very short integration time, was 2 cm. And on the left you see the standard deviation of the noise, of the Doppler noise, at 1 second integration time, which you see is fairly large, is about 300 microns per second. 300 microns per second is 3 in 10 to the minus 4 meters per second, which is 0.3 millimeters per second, which is fairly large, but at 1 second integration time. If one integrates over longer times, this error goes like 1 over square root of the integration time, external noise after all. So, for example, at 1000 second, we have to decrease this number by square root of 1000, which is about 30. So we get down to 0.01 millimeter per second at that integration time, much smaller. Okay? It's interesting to to see what is the effect, for example, of the wind. This path showed relatively large noise, both for Doppler and for range. And this is a record of the wind speed at the ground antenna. And you can see that at a certain point, at 25, reached at a certain point in the path, 25 meters per second. All antennas are designed to track up to a certain wind speed. When the wind speed reaches, as in this case, 30 meters per second, which corresponds to about 100 kilometers per hour, the tracking has to be interrupted and the antenna had to be placed in a so-called stalled position. Stalled means that this is, if this is the support structure, the stalled position is this one. So the dish faces zenith for protection. Okay? And in this first pass that we got, the wind became so strong that we had to interrupt tracking. It's interesting to see also what this plot. This is the plot of the Allan deviation. The Allan deviation, as I told you, sigma y, as a function of the integration time, is equal to a dev, is approximately equal to delta f over f integrated over a time tau. Okay, so this is the square of this averaged and square root of. So the Allan deviation is proportional to the range rate error and 10 to the minus 14 corresponds to 1 to 10 to the minus 6 meters per second. Ok? Actually, 3 in 10 to the minus 6 meter per second. So you can write this equivalence. And you can see here that the Allan deviation was pretty large. This dip, which is also seen spectral-wise in the power spectrum as a line at exactly around replay time, is the product of the shaking of the antenna. And you see that at 1000 seconds we are having large, fairly large error in range rate. Another day is also interesting, and I show you these examples to give you an idea of how things are done. So these are Doppler residuals, and you remember from what we learned in the first part of the course what residuals are observed minus computed. So we did an orbital fit on the Doppler and range measurements, and this is the leftover, what is leftover. The range rate that you see here show an Allan deviation, this a standard deviation, an RMS value this time is slightly smaller by a factor of 2, smaller than in the previous case. Again, integration time is only 1 second. And look range. The range residuals that you see on the right show a quite apparently unusual behavior because In this part of the past, everything is more or less stable. We get flat residuals with no signatures, so you would say, okay, these are reasonable residuals. We have been able to flatten down the residuals in this first part of the past. And in the second part of the past, on the contrary, you see all these signatures. And what I told you is that when you see signatures in the residuals, this may be an indication of a poor orbital fit. A poor orbital fit. But the truth is different. The orbital fit is correct. The data are, however, affected by non-stationary noise. So this is an example of non-white noise. If you look at the standard deviation, okay, across the path, is only slightly more 1.2 centimeter. So averaged over the entire path duration, and the entire path duration is about 6 hours. You see, from 6 a.m., May 20, everything is UTC, of course, to 14. Actually, these are 8 hours of tracking path. And it's quite good, apparently, but there are signatures in the residuals. And if you look at what the wind does, you see, this is measured by an anemometer. And in the first part of the pass, the wind speed stays at relatively low values, 4 meters per second, but then increases, it picks up. You see here, in this part, it picks up, and what we see here is the effect of the wind. Clearly is the effect of the wind, and probably is are air masses of water vapor which are transported by the wind across the line of sight. So if you see residuals like this, it's a warning against what I told you previously, in a sense. Why? Because we told you that your solution is good as long as you see flat residuals, the orbital solution. In this case, the solution is shows signatures, but these signatures are not due to a poor job in getting the orbital solution, but to the presence of non-stationary noise, noise which is non-stationary. So what do you do in this case, in the presence of non-stationary noise? Well, what I would do is to divide the path in two parts. Divide the path in two parts. One is this, where the residuals are more or less flat, and then in this second pass compute the RMS value and perhaps increase by some factor of two arbitrarily in order to make sure that this data do not bias the solution, okay? And use a different weight for this part of the tracking path. The same is true for the Doppler, you see? Also, the Doppler shows this behavior, this anomalous behavior, and gets noisier in the second part of the path. It's interesting to see that if we compare the range residuals, and this is the same plot that I showed you before, with the integrated Doppler, okay, with the integrated Doppler, which is shown on the right here, on the left, excuse me. So we integrate the Doppler to get a delta range. And you see the integrated Doppler is pretty much in agreement with the delta range, because you see this peak is seen here. This peak is seen here. This peak corresponds to this peak and then goes down. And so on. So it means really that Doppler and range are completely consistent in identifying the nature of the phenomenon, and they are in sync. Okay? But range is an absolute measurement and gives you the distance between the ground antenna and the spacecraft. Integrated Doppler tells you only by how much the distance has varied in a given time. And if you look at the effect of the noise in the integrated Doppler, which is here, you see that the integrated Doppler corresponds to a displacement up to, in this point, 5 millimeters. Okay, 5 millimeters. So this is something interesting. This is the best pass that we ever obtained, which still shows in range some signatures. Look, in this pass where the wind was fairly low and the conditions were good, we are at 7 millimeters. So essentially, we have a radio system that behaves better than a laser system, and that can be used everywhere in the solar system for spacecraft navigation. So this was a really outstanding result. Okay? Look also the standard deviation of the Doppler now has decreased significantly. Just to show one final slide. This is a slide showing the Allan deviation, which we learned is proportional to range rate error. And we know that 10 to the minus 14 corresponds to 3 in 10 to the minus 6 meters per second. So this is the integration time. It tells you what is the range rate error at if we integrate. If we have a measurement every 10 seconds, every 100 seconds, or every 1000 seconds. And the blue line, which is this one here, is the Bepicolombo requirement. The requirement that we set on the basis of which we designed the experiment. We means the science team that I'm the PI, principal investigator of, the industry, Thales Alenia Space, and the European Space Agency. So we agreed on this performance. And we see that in many, many occasions, okay, we have at least five passes where the results were better than the specs. There were two passes, forget about the one in blue, which are here. One was the high wind, and the other one was the decommissioning. There are only two passes, these two, actually, two or There is the black, the purple, and also a red, three passes, which sometimes exceed the design specs. Of course, one cannot do anything against wind. If you are in a windy day, you have to expect worse measurements, bad measurements. But we have seen that for a significant amount of time of passes, we exceeded the experiment performance. So I will stop here on to show these results from Bepi Colombo, which are quite interesting, and let us go back to our to the main topic we were dealing. Sorry, this is what I had to show. To make some considerations on more general consideration on the use of these radiometric measurements for orbit determinations, and these considerations are quite important. Suppose, well, what I want to highlight now is that good measurement by themselves can produce odd, strange results, and sometimes even wrong results if not taken with care, and if especially the dynamical model is not adequate to the quality of the measurements. Having too good of me measurements in the presence of a poor dynamical model may produce big errors and big mistakes. Let us consider the following example. Suppose that you have a spacecraft. I have to take the pen again. Suppose that you have the spacecraft on this trajectory, putative trajectory, and the navigation team has followed this trajectory for a while, so it's very confident that this is the true trajectory. If the navigation team projects the trajectory using the same dynamical model after a certain time, and suppose that here, after a certain time, this is the projected trajectory over time, and suppose that the navigation team, in order to get this trajectory, uses range measurements. Okay? Uses range measurements. So the last range measurement that they have is this R0. Could be 10 to the 8 kilometers, less than an astronomical unit, perhaps in the same situation as Bepi Colombo, showing that I showed before. And all of a sudden, however, there are stray accelerations, stray forces, which are not included in the dynamical model, are not included in the dynamical model, which take the spacecraft away from the predicted trajectory. So the true path is this one. Suppose that, for example, you have an example of this stray acceleration can be a valve leak, a tiny leak from a valve, which gives a constant, tiny, constant acceleration. So this is the true path, but the navigator believed that the spacecraft must be on this path or something similar to this path. Now, you do, at this time when the spacecraft is here, you do a range measurement R1. And R1 turns out to be R0 plus 5 meters. Plus 5 meters. Because the spacecraft has deviated from the trajectory. Now, remember that these 5 meters increase means that the spacecraft can be on a sphere of range R1 equal to R0 plus 5 meters. This is R0, slightly below. And of course, if you believe the measurement, and the measurement is true, the measurement doesn't lie, then in order to put the spacecraft on a sphere which is has a radius 5 meters larger than R0 and stays on the predicted trajectory, you have to put the spacecraft here, very far away. And if you compute the distance, this is about 1,000 kilometers. If I magnified what I've done here, I magnify it. So this is the other sphere. The horizontal displacement that one gets is huge. So to have a radius of that amount, it means that the spacecraft must be at a location which is absolutely incompatible with the predicted trajectory, because the navigators would better predict the spacecraft to be here. And they found it more than 1,000, almost 1,000 kilometers away. Of course, this doesn't mean that they believe that the spacecraft has accelerated so much along the predicted trajectory. The navigators immediately realize that there must be something wrong. And what is wrong is either the measurement, those 5 meters, or the dynamical model. And in the example that I gave you here, the error stays in the dynamical model. So they have to take actions, revisit the dynamical model, or deweight completely the range measurement, which is not a good idea, by the way, because the range measurement can be reliable and is reliable. What they have to do is to revisit the dynamical model and introduce, in this case, stochastic accelerations and introduce stochastic dynamical models, unless they understand what happened on board, perhaps looking at the telemetry, seeing whether there is some indication that a valve may be leaking, so on and so forth. Dynamical model, which are stochastic, you have seen them associated to the Kalman filter for attitude determination, right? And this one can do the same. Here is more complicated than in the case of attitude determination, but it can be done in the same way. So finally, let me see if I have time. Yes, I have some time. So this is an important point, the one that I make, in the previously. Good measurements must always be matched by a good dynamical model. And if there is any mismatch, if there is something fishy in the orbital solution, well, either you try to refine the dynamical model and see what happened on board the spacecraft, which is always a good idea, or you use stochastic dynamical models. I can tell you also a story regarding this. And the story led to a crash, the failure of a mission. The mission was called Mars Climate Orbiter. And what the navigators noticed at a certain time was that after every desaturation maneuver of the wheels, the spacecraft was on a trajectory which was incompatible with the predictions. Okay, incompatible with the predictions. Very strange. So the spacecraft deviated and the navigator said to adjust the solution by a significant amount. Every wheel desaturation maneuver, as you have learned, produces torques on the spacecraft, but since the thrusters are generally unbalanced, there is also a net force produced. This net force can be computed fairly well and must be taken into account. The navigators took it into account and thought to took it into account in the right way. However, the control of the wheel desaturation and the metrics of the wheel desaturations were held by Lockheed Martin, at the time Martin Marietta, the manufacturer of the spacecraft, who provided a conversion table to the navigation team, saying, okay, if we apply this torque to the spacecraft, this is what you have to expect as delta V. The problem was that in this conversion, the Martin Marietta used imperial units. Okay, so pound per foot, not Newton per meter for the torque. And the delta V that resulted was completely wrong, always by a constant factor, because JPL, the navigators of the spacecraft, navigation of the spacecraft was done at JPL, they used metric units. And this led to this mismatch. So after every desaturation maneuver, there was a mismatch between the predicted trajectory and the actual trajectory. And the navigators had to make an adjustment, but they didn't really understand why the adjustment was needed. So they, in this case, there is a notification process, and the problem was put to the attention of the project manager. However, the project manager put it at priority number 16, so much lower than other problems that he was facing at that time. So essentially, it didn't receive any attention. And when Mars was approaching and the maneuver, the orbit insertion maneuver had to be done, the spacecraft was on a course which was quite different from what the navigator estimated because of this problem. And in fact, instead of being at 200 kilometers above Mars' surface, it was at 70 kilometers. The net result was that Mars Climate Orbiter crashed into the atmosphere of Mars because of this navigation error that ultimately was driven by a disagreement or a mismatch in the units to be used. And you can see how a space mission can fail for stupid things. If we are using different units, if two individuals are using different units, of course the mission can fail and can fail miserably. This was the case of Mars Climate Orbiter in the year 2000. Around the year 2000, it was a failure that made really to the press, because a failure that should not have occurred. All right. So I see that our time is finished, and we will continue and finish tomorrow with Delta DOR, the angular measurements. I have to say one final things on of caveat about the use of the combination of different data types, range for example, and range rate. I will stay for another 2 3 minutes to see whether there are questions, and because I have another class shortly after. Okay. So please don't hesitate to ask questions if you have any. No, Delta DOR will not be the last topic. I want to tell you something about system engineering. We will do my idea is that we will do something on system engineering, so we will go back to part one. I know that you have done something also with Professor Gaudenzi, but I want to show you some real example of a real mission on the problems that one faces with the system engineering. Anyway, let us decide tomorrow because I wanted to reserve at least 1 hour, perhaps on Thursday, for questions about the whole program. And we will do this on Google Meet, not on YouTube. So, if you deem necessary, if you want clarifications on special topics, etc., we can do a session and use 1 hour of the final day, for example, to a Google Meet session of question and answer on the entire program. Let me know if you deem this useful or necessary. Otherwise, I will continue with the program. Tomorrow, Delta DOR will not take us more than 1 hour. Okay, so if there are no questions, I will stop here streaming and see you tomorrow at 10 o'clock. Goodbye, goodbye to everyone.